Please welcome our next speaker, Stefano Demiliani, a DevOps engineer, TCO, and Microsoft MVP. Today, he will be presenting Coding for Performances in AL Extensions. Please stick around after Stefano's session for a live Q&A.
Welcome everybody to Dynamics Con. Thanks to be here on this conference, and thanks for having voted for these sessions. I'm Stefano Demiliani from Italy. I'm a Microsoft MVP for business application and an MCT. I work as a CTO for a company in Italy, and my main expertise are Business Central and Azure development or cloud development in general. Today, we are here to talk for a particular topic. The topic is creating code for performances in AL extensions, mainly with the focus mainly to the cloud environment. Feel free to ask questions every time you want, directly in the chat or at the end of the session. So, the main problem, the fact is that a not optimized or well-written code, but you write solution for Business Central, can absolutely create performance problems. And performance problems are not always so visible. So if you have a larger number of users or a pure amount of data, also if you have a bad code, and it seems fast, so you go fast. But the same code with a large number of users and with a large number of data seems slow. Can seem slow. So the problem here that we want to affect during this session is writing code for performances. The first, when talking about performances, before thinking on the code side, we should always start from the data structure design. So this is the main part that you should check. So if you want to have an efficient solution and a performance solution, you need to have an efficient data structure. So create tables. When you create tables, use the right keys, and create secondary keys if you have heavy loops. So it's extremely important to create secondary keys for heavy loops and use the set current key or something like that for using the right indexes when you loops. Another common question that comes from the past is flow fields. Flow fields are fields that are automatically calculated from Business Central. And these are performance, absolutely, a power of the platform, but don't abuse on flow fields because they can slow your code. And if you use flow fields, remember that you can do different fields with flow fields. Something to avoid is having something like this, so a loop, where inside the loop you calculate the fields, the flow fields, the balance in this example, and then you do things related to these flow fields. It's much better to use a new instructions available in a AL language called set autocal fields that permits you to do the execute the query for the calculations before the loops. So this is not executed every time you loops it on any records, but the query is executed at the beginning of the loop, and this is much more performant. Remember also that you should always use instruction that works on bulk records if you want to modify bulk records. So modify all, delete all can improve performances by limiting the amount of SQL code needed for modifying or deleting records. So you should always use modify all and delete all when you have bulk operations. But remember that also if you use modify all or delete all, these can be reverted to individual calls, so individual modify or individual delete, if you are under certain conditions. So for example, if you have triggers code in the tables, triggers code is executed and your operation is reverted to a single operation. If you have event subscribers to the on before modify or after modify or on before or on before delete or after delete or events like this, the code is reverted to a single code. Also, if you have security filter active, also your table contains media or media set data type, the bulk operation are converted into single operation. And also, if you have fields that are added to this table, true companion table, so true extension. So remember that a table extension, we'll talk about that later, can affect also your bank operations. Another important aspect to remember when writing code for performance is related to the right data types to use. This is the IL language comes with a set of built-in data structures optimized for performances and for the server resources, so avoid too much server resource consumption. I see that a lot of partners don't use this new right data structure. So my recommendation is use these new data structures. So for example, when concatenating strings, text builder is much more better than use plus equals operator. If you need the key value data structures, now you have the dictionary value type that you can use and it's much more performant. You have the list data type now. If you want to have an unbound array, previously, for example, to create an unbound array, you should use temporary tables. Now you have lists that are very useful. Media or media set, if you work on data, blob data, are much more performant instead of declaring blob data, because data is cached on the client in this case. And why blob is never cached. And it's always fetched from database. And so it's much more performant on this. And just to give you a very, very quick example on some of these things that can seem stupid, but are not so stupid when talking about performances. Consider, for example, this loop for concatenating strings. This loop simply loop for a large number of iterations, obviously, and concatenates the strings by using the plus equals operator. This second loop is the same operations, but instead of using the plus equals, it uses the append method of the new text builder objects. If you have 100 of loops, so 100 of loops of these two codes performs the same way. So 6 milliseconds is the way for executing these loops. But if you increase the number of records to work on these loops, for example, to this number of loops, you can see that the difference in performance are extremely different. So the first loop by using plus equals is about 4 seconds, while the other loops is about only 40 milliseconds. So the gains on performance is extremely big if you use the new data types for AL. Another interesting tips that you should always remember is that you should always use set operation instead of looping over records. So find set and so on are operations that are optimized for data objects. An example of a bad code that you can see, especially if you migrate solution from old version of NIV to the new IL language, you convert code. You can have operations like this where you filter and imagine that this is an EV table, so the GL entry with lots of records. You can first you set a key with where there's a fields in this key. You filter for one of all these fields in the key that you use for the loops, and then inside loops the loops is handled in this way with a while find first, terrible way, and you modify these fields inside that loops. This is an extremely killer of performances because there's a lot of errors inside this piece of code. It works, obviously. If you have poor amount of data, no problem. But if you have a large set of data, this can be a large problem and affect performances. So it's much more better to rewrite raw code in this way, where you use the same a key that does not contain the fields that you want to modify. So in this way, we are using a key with the account number and the posting date. We filter for the account number and posting date, and then the field that you want to modify. And here we use the find set, maybe with a true operator if you want to modify records. And we modify the records inside that. This is much more performance, avoid locks, and also resource consumption is better. So a recommendation are to not modify a field that is included in the key while you loops. Always remember that set operations are better for looping, so find set is faster than using find for first and find last. please don't count records by using find first or something like that, but use is empty, for example. And operations like afils, calcsum, and setup of afils are faster than looping over the result set and running the calculations. So please use this. And a sentence that I want to emphasize always, that your code should be tested with big data sets, because as said at the beginning, if we have poor code, a poor amount of data, and your code is not well written, yeah, you cannot see the differences. Another tips that I want to leave is when you write code, use what is called the lazy evaluation. Lazy evaluation is a technique, an evaluation strategy, which permits you to holding the evaluation on an expression until its value is needed. So, for example, if I need to filter the gerentry table, and I have a procedure here where I have the gerentry table record and I have a Boolean check, and I want to execute a exit of this function if the find set is true, so if I have some records, and if check is true. Two conditions means the place in OR means that the engine must calculate this and must calculate this. So OR are executed. It's much more better to rewrite the operation in this way. So first the check with the most quickest condition. So checking on the Boolean. If the Boolean is false, the OR is false. So we can exit immediately. Otherwise, I can execute the find set on the gerent, that is most easy operations. Same things with an end condition, for example. If our business case is written in this way, so if we need to do the Boolean condition and in end with the find set operation, it's much better to write the code in this way. If check, which so the most quick check, and then if it's okay, the find set. This is the same as executing the code in end, but it's much quicker, because if the first is not true, we directly don't execute the find set operation. Another aspect when writing code for performances is related to events. You should always use events in your extension, because events are the way and the key for customization and for extensions. Events means that extensions should have published events, so event publisher, and event publisher has no impact on performance. So please use event publisher inside your code in order to permit customization. And after event publisher, you should have event subscriber. So you should subscribe from your extension to events, standard events or custom events, and write your custom code in the event subscriber. When you have event subscriber, remember that event subscribers can affect performances. So it's much better to try avoiding a long chain of subscribers. So don't have a long chain of subscribers. Remember that the size of the subscriber co-unit can impact performances. So the smaller the subscriber co-unit is, and better is. As said before, if you subscribe to table events, remember that this can affect bulk operations. So if you have event subscriber to the on after modify event of the table, remember that this event subscriber can avoid using the modify all on that table, because all modify all operations are converted into single modify. And another interesting tip, at least in my opinion, is that the single instance co-units for subscribers are better. So for example, imagine that I have this co-unit. I call it my event handler, and in this co-unit I have all my event subscribers. So for example, I have an event subscriber that subscribe the sales post co-unit, and the event that subscribe the on before post sales document, and inside that I execute my business logic. Having this means that each time I post a document, this event subscriber is executed, and an instance of this co-unit is thrown in memory, executed in memory, and my code is executed. So this is not optimized in terms of performances. I think that it's much better to use a pattern like this. So, for example, this code unit should be single instance. Single instance means that only one instance of this code unit is creating to this session. So, first time is creating, and then it's the next time is not creating. And the RSS subscriber first should be local. So, local means that in a single instance code unit, we should not have global variables because local variables, all local others are immediately destroyed. So, it's much better to use local variables. And as said before, in the event subscriber, I call my business logic, but my business logic is much better to call that business logic, maintain that business logic in another code unit, because the code unit of subscribers smaller are better. So here I don't create the business logic like in this case directly into this code unit. I call it an external code unit with the business logic. And maybe, if possible, I can also add a condition in order to throw the business logic. So not directly throw the business logic and then inside the business logic check the condition, because, for example, as in this example, I want the business logic only for if the opening type is order. But I directly check here and the business logic is executed only if the conditions are met. So this is much more performant in term instead of using something like this. Also, reports can affect performances. So, related to reports, my suggestions are always to suggest filters for the users in order to don't avoid that your users execute the report and read all the data. So, always suggest filter with like record filter fields. The report should have less data as possible. So, remove and use a column from data items. If possible, try to use queries instead of data items because they are much more performant, especially on reads. Obviously, the reports can contain code, so all tips related to code that we see now should be used inside the reports. And in reports, remember that you can also execute the report in the real-only replica if possible. And accordingly to that, please remember that Business Central is based on Azure SQL, and Azure SQL in the premium level supports what is called the read scale-out feature. So it has a built-in read-only replica available for you, enabled by default. And when you create a report or a query or an API page, you can set a property of these objects. The property is data access intent. If you set it as read-only, this means that this report will be executed not directly into the production database, but in the read-only replica of the production database. Real-time sync in sync with the production. And if you have reports that does statistic or something like that, this is much more performant and don't affect users. So please use these properties. And you can remember that you can also set the user in via the user interface into the data access intent page. Query objects are another important object that can impact performances on your code. So query object in IL is an object that permits you to retrieve records from one or more tables and combine tables. So you can also join tables and something like that. You can perform calculations and something like that. When you define a query object, you can define a query object of two types, a normal query object. Normal query object means that it's a query that you can use in your IL code or in a page. And or an API. An API means that you have another data endpoint that you can expose to your external services. And a query can have the query type top property set as API, and this means that it will be exposed as APIs. Queries has some pros and cons. Pros mean pros of a query are that not all fields are read from the database. So if you use queries, only the fields that you specify into the query are read from the database. The other no. So read performances are extremely fast. And you can also join multiple tables and have a single data set with joins of multiple tables. The cons of a query is that the main cons of a query, in my opinion, is that the query is not cached. So data on a query is always read from SQL. And I see installations from customers that use queries on, for example, role centers. I not suggest to don't do that, because query on role centers can impact performance of the role center. I execute each time you access the role centers, and it can slow down your experience. A query, remember also that the result set of a query cannot be, are not guaranteed to be dynamic, because if you insert or modify data in the result set not yet, where you have not done a loop, it's not guaranteed that the query includes the changes that maybe someone has done. So please remember this. An interesting hidden property of a query is that you can also specify a query category property of the query object by specifying a comma-separated list of page where you want to display that query. And you can, this is a nice way, in my opinion, to permit to your user to directly execute your query directly from, for example, a list page. And having an experience to your user to execute a query and have a user interface without creating a page and opening the record set and something like that. Another important point related to performances in code is using of partial records. Partial record is a new feature available in the Yale language for loading a subset of fields instead of retrieving all the data source. An example, if imagine that I want to loop on the item table, a large item table, to calculate the unit cost. Instead of doing something like this, so find set and you calculate the unit cost, these loops means that the find set operation does a select star from the item table plus joins with all the table extensions that extends the item tables. So it retrieves a lot of fields with a lot of joins, also for tables that we don't want to retrieve. It's much better now to do something like this. So you can call the set load fields with the fields that you want to retrieve and looping in this way, exactly like before. This is much more performant because it's as a, like executing a select unit cost from without the joins. And so you don't execute joins, and only the needed fields are retrieved, and the joins with all the table extension that you can have is not executed. So performance gains. Partial records are what you should always use, in especially in read-only operations. Partial record has also some drawbacks that I want to emphasize. Some of them I think that are poor documented, but for example, it's not recommended to use partial records if you want to insert, delete, rename, or do things like transfer fields or something like that, because these are all operations that requires all fields, that all fields of this record are loaded in memory. And if you don't, you don't do that, but use set of fields, and then you do an insert or delete a record or transfer fields or something like that, the engine, the platform will emit a just-in-time load of the records, and you lose all the performance gain that you had in before. And also, there's what I think is a hidden limit of the load fields is, for example, that if you have a table with the flow fields with the, where the call formula is specified as field x equals field y. All it's if you use set load fields, the operation is on SQL is not a select the fields that you want to retrieve, but also this field that you want to retrieve plus all the fields that you have specified into the call formula. So there are a small drawbacks, because not only one field is retrieved as in the first example before, but also the fields needed to calculate the cut fields. Another aspect that I think I've experienced with some problems if you use operations like this. So for example, use set load fields, and then you modify a field inside the loop. This can be a problem, especially if you have some other subscribers. As in this case, I modified a loop, a field, not loaded. And here I'm checking a rankings rack. This has two drawbacks, actually, at least until version 17.3. It should be fixed on 17.4. Accessing an unloaded field causes a just-in-time load, so you gain performance, you lose performances. And here also, a check with XREC. So all audit fields are compared when checking if any memory row is a consistent or not. So rec XREC, if you compare rec XREC, all the fields are compared. So you have a just-in-time load of the data into the from the database, and all the fields are compared. So also fields like system modified at, system modified date, and so on. And you can have a consistent error. So what I recommend is use the set load fields always in read-option or read-only scenarios, because it's where you gain a lot on performances. Another problematic trigger, in my opinion, is the on company open. If you have code that subscribe to the on company open trigger, you should not have this, in my opinion. But if you have this, because maybe you want to log things or something like that, please remember that the on company open trigger is executing every time a new session is opened. And a new session in Business Center can be opened or can be of different types. You can have web client session, desktop session, phone, tablet, but also web services, background, and so on. And this is what where the impact is. So if you don't check, for example, like in this way, imagine that I want to log things on your company open. And if I want to log things, I want to log things related to users. So I need to check only the session related to user. I don't want web services, job queue session, and something like that. Because otherwise, this trigger is executed every time you have a web service access, every time you have a job queue, and so on. So please remember that if you have code that subscribe to this trigger, check that the session type. Pages. Pages are where the user experience has a user experience. So to have efficient pages, you should have pages that do less. So don't avoid heavy operations on the on-after get record trigger. Avoid to have too much flow fields. It's much better to have, in different cases, it's much better to have dedicated lookup pages instead of using standard lookup pages, because they're much more performance, because you don't have, you avoid extra calculations. You should offload the UI thread as much as possible. And to do that, there are a set of techniques in Business Central today. And I suggest to use the page background task, for example, if you want to have calculation in the background and then returning the data to the column page, because it permits you to avoid the user to wait for a long running calculation to be executed. So the experience is much more performant. Remember that in Business Center, you have different ways, at least four ways to start the task in the background: the job queue, the task scheduler, the start session operation, and the page background task. Some of these, like task and job queue, survive a server restart, so it's like enqueuing a task. Are useful if you want to schedule a task that survives to server restarts. Otherwise, page background task and start session are the best way to do. Remember that page background tasks are useful only for read-only operations, while start session, you can also execute code unit into a start session in this way. And this will be executed into a background task, a background process. A new session is creating, and this code unit is executing into that new session. If you use start session, you can do write transaction. So you can avoid the limitation of the page background task, but remember that you should be aware of deadlocks, because you are executing that code in another session, and you can sometimes have problems on deadlocks if you don't do things carefully. Performance affects also web services. Web services, to having performant code, you should avoid UI pages, expose UI pages as web services, because these are contains code that is not optimized. It's absolutely recommended to use API pages now, because are born to be exposed. Please don't use temporary table as source of a web service if you have many records, because these are performance hit. And remember that if you want OData endpoints that do data readers, sometimes is much more performant instead of using API pages, is much more performant to use API queries, maybe with the data access inter read only flag. So they will join tables into the read only replica. And if you have batch operations to do, you can also use the batch endpoint for all the APIs and does operation into the batch in a batch way, much more performant. Now, what, in my opinion, impacts more the performance of in the cloud is the topic related to table extension. Table extension, I think that everyone of you here knows that Business Center, if you have a table, in the customer table, for example, and you extend the customer table, it creates a new table called with the name of your extension and the base app ID and your app ID. This table extension contains the primary key of the extended table plus all custom keys. If you do a fine set of the customer table, the fine set operation is joined with the base table on every invocation from EIL code. So every time you call the customer into your code, the customer is joined with all the table extension you have. And actually, it's not current possible to define indexes that span base in extension fields. So table extension are performance killer, and the factor that affects performance with table extension are mainly the size of the table, extended table, the number of records, the frequency of access, and the number of extensions that you have. And I've done a performance misuration some times ago that you can find more in details on this link. You can do that also in your installations. Simply create a table with some fields and then create a set of different extensions that simply adds a table extension to this base table by adding a new fields. So first extension, second extension, third extension, and so on. And then start load a large amount of records into that table and open the page inside the table. You can see that after a number of extensions, my measuration, it was 5-6 extensions that I extend the same table. You can start see that Business Center is showing you that it's working before loading data. And to show you the impact, you can see that with 1 million of records, if I open a table without table extension, this is the time needed. With one table extension of this table, this is the time needed. With two table extensions that add feeds to the same table, this is the time needed, and so on. So you can see that with 5 or 6 table extensions that add fields to the same table, we have a percent of performance gain, performance loss is terrible. So if you have table extension, please be careful of this. Don't have too much table extension. And to having table extension, I know that sometimes is poor design. Sometimes too much table extension comes not directly from a developer, but also from the marketing side. So what I see a lot of partners that wants to split their solution into different extensions because the marketing department wants to have a solution that can be sell into modules, different modules. And I see a lot of partners that are in this situation. So where, for example, I have an app one that extends this table and this table of the base app. I have this app that extends this table and this table and this table. I have this app that extend this and this and so on. So if you put all this up into the same database, because you sell to your customer all these modules, performance gains, performance can decrease because you have a lot of different extension of the same table. In these scenarios, sometimes it's much better to use something like a library app. A library app means that you can have a hidden app, then where you can have the extension of the base table that you want, and all your different apps that you want to maintain separated apps can be dependent of the library app only. So you, in this way, you have an app, the library app, that is automatically deployed together with your apps. So when you deploy in app one, for example, the library app is automatically installed into your tenant. And the library app is updated each time you update one app that depends on the library app. This permits you to, it's a technique quite interesting sometimes to reduce the number of table extensions that you have. Because you avoid to have too much extension into the same table, because in this way you have only one extension of the table one, only one of the table two, and so on. So it's a technique that you should remember and sometimes use. So table extension are very performance killer impact. I think that is one of the main performance killer that we have now in Business Central. You should be careful on having too much extension that extends the same table, especially if this is an heavy table. You should be careful on having too much extension on a large table. Sometimes related tables could help. Partial record loading can increase performances because, as said in the previous slide, where with the graphics of the performance gains I measured, if you use partial records, all the joins are not executed, and performances are quite the same as having one single stable extension. And you should also spend time on while designing your solution architecture. So if you have a large set of apps, start thinking on your solution architecture, start thinking on library apps and something like that. And as a last topic, very quickly, I want to show that, to say you that you can also yourself measure performances and unit test your performances. For example, by creating tests that measure the number of queries that you, or the number of reads that you execute into your code, execute into the SQL engine. These are sometimes quite interesting for checking performances. And for example, you can use the SQL rows read method that gets the amount of SQL rows read into the session, or the SQL statement executed method that gets the amount of SQL statement executed on that sessions. And you can sometimes have code, for example, if I have a loop where I want to measure the number of reads, you can do something like this. And session information dot SQL rows read and having the number of reads performed. And you can see if, for example, the number of rows reads is over a certain threshold, something like that. So you can monitor how your SQL engine performs. Please remember, and please sometimes you monitor performances also by using unit testing. And remember, I repeat that sentence. Remember that to monitor performance is extremely important to having a testing environment with lots of data. So please load your environment with lots of data. Otherwise, you cannot discover if you have performance problem. And please use telemetry, especially on SaaS. Please activate telemetry. Please activate Application Insights. Application Insights gives you a lot of signals to monitor telemetry. And you should check that signals, and they permit you to discover performance problem and or at least start discovering what objects have performance problems. So that's all for me now. I invite you also to the live Q&A after this session. Please remember these tips. Thanks for joining DynamicsCon. Thanks to all the sponsors that has worked with us to have this nice conference for the Business Central community. Thanks for attending the session again, and see you in the live Q&A. Bye-bye. Thank you guys to attend DynamicsCon. I hope that the session was interesting, and I hope to have given you some tips on working with the Business Central and in terms of performances. DynamicsCon was a great conference, so congrats to all the attendees and congrats to all the organizers for the lots of sessions done in these 3 days. I collected some questions that comes in the chat. I see in the chat that most of people raises some sessions. I have some questions are raised on other channels. So I can try to answer some of them. First question was related to the risk allowed features. The risk allowed features is a features available from Business Central 15, if I remember. And it depends on Azure SQL. So with Business Central, you have automatically a read-only replica available for you where you can work. And yes, the answer was if risk allowed is supported on-premise, the answer is yes. But remember that on-premise, you require a supported SQL version. SQL version first must be 2016 and later. And then require a SQL version that supports what is called the read-only routing. So the ability to SQL Server to route read-only connections requests to an available always on readable secondary replica. So it means that you need the SQL Enterprise or something like that. Another question related to this was if licensing for read-only replica. Licensing for read-only replica is if a read-only replica on-premise must be licensed, and if I remember, the answer is yes, because for always-on availability group licensing, when you have a secondary replica actively used, you need to fully license that replica. If you work on premise, remember that not all is free and not all is automatically available, but you need something like that. If you go on Azure SQL, for example, Azure SQL, if you go with some version of Azure SQL, like premium version, premium tier of Azure SQL, they have automatically read-only replica available. Other questions is, why the on-company open event is so critical? I experienced that the event is critical on many situations because this event is triggered every time a new session is open. So also when you have things like web services, background tasks, and so on, so not session that you want to raise maybe your code inside that trigger. Your code added on this event can be triggered also if you don't want. So this can affect performances. And remember also that your company open trigger can also affect performances like during the login phase. So you can give it to your user sign-in experience affected. So I don't recommend to do things on this trigger. I'm interested in the library app concept. Can you explain more? Yes, the library app concept is one of the available techniques that you can use on AppSource, for example, if you want to avoid to have a long chain of apps and a long chain of dependencies between apps. It simply, AppSource permits you to upload what is called an in-library app that is like an hidden app that you can upload on AppSource together with one of your app, the real app that you want to upload on AppSource. Obviously, the real app must be dependent from the library. You can have on the library all your layers, data layers, for example, tables and so on. And on top of that, you can have different apps on AppSource that depends on the library. And the magic of the library app is that it's automatically deployed with your app. And so when someone downloads app one, your library is installed. And when someone downloads then app two from app source, the library is, the system checks you have if you have the library or if you have the library updated. If not, it downloads the library for you. And so it's magically handled by you, by the app source engine. And it's sometimes depends of your extensions, of your projects, but it's sometimes a good way of avoiding dependencies or reducing dependencies between apps. Other question, is it better to use pages exposed as OData or APIs for speed? I suggest normally to use API pages, because API pages are born to be used as external services, while pages exposed as OData, normally a page is born for to serve the user interface. It can contain code that is triggered not for the external integrations, but for the user interface applications. API pages are born for this, and API pages are improved in terms of performances. So API pages are actually 6 or 7 times faster from version 16 than in the previous versions. And if you need for speed, API pages are much better and a good solution on many scenarios. If you want, especially read records, is to use API queries instead of API pages. Maybe API queries that uses read-only replica. And remember also that the API queries uses partial records internally, because they use metadata to generate which fields need to be loaded. So are optimized for that. Yes, I agree with Eric that says that if you want to avoid dependencies, just create a monolith. it's a possible way. How can I generally monitor the performances of my tenant? For monitoring the performance issues of a business center online, normally I recommend to use Application Insights, that is an Azure service born for this. So simply you create an instance of Application Insights, connect it to your online tenant, and when connected, all your signals from your tenant will be redirected to App Insights. When your signals are redirected to App Insights, you will have lots of signals available for analyzing your environments, from long-running queries, logs, page views, authorization problems, web service requests, and more. And you can analyze this data from the portal, Azure portal, from PowerShell, from more user-friendly or consultant-friendly tools like Power BI. So App Insights is, in my opinion, a good way for analyzing performances, and is where the product team is investing a lot. Is there a limit on API data? If I remember, there's no limit on the number of records returned by an API page, but there's a limit on the execution. So you can return tons of records, hundreds and thousands of records, but remember that you have a limit on the execution, that it's, if I remember, 10 minutes. Best way, recommended way, if you want to use APIs for integrating with external application, is first use API pages. Second is, if you need only to expose data, use the read scale out. And sometimes it's much better to use not pages, exposed API pages, but API queries. When using set load fields, is there a warning or error if I use a field not previously loaded? I think that there's no an error for sure. I think that now there's a warning on CodeCop, but I'm not sure that it's available only on the preview version of the IL language extension, or if it's also in the 6.x version of the IL language. I'm sure that on the 7 version there's a warning of CodeCop. No, there's not an error. Well, you can use several fields, and then you can also read a field that is not in the fields previously loaded. But if you try to access a field not loaded, normally it's a just-in-time reading. So an implicit get operation on the record is done. And gets calls can often be served by the server's data cache or become cluster index, so are much more performant than filtering or something like that. No monoliths anymore, please. I agree. I agree. I'm not a huge fan of the Yo Monolith application, and so I suggest to split. As Eric said previously, I suggested to split your apps into different apps and working on these accordingly. So with libraries, with something like that, but don't do monoliths now. Other questions that I see? Okay, I answered a question that was not here, but raised on my phone that is ringing. I've tried to monitor with App Insights the API request on my tenant, but I had problems on discovering the status of the request. Where is the HTTP status? I agree. This is not easy because the API call sends a request to App Insights with a simple log called web service call, and you need to expand it. This trace has a dimensions field. You need to expand the dimension fields, and inside the dimension field you can see the status code, the HTTP status code. So you can monitor if you want to monitor for App Insights all your API queries that maybe was success or was not success. For example, normally you monitor what is not success. You can simply do on App Insights traces where operation name equals web service call, because you have, in this case, you have the entire log of your web service call and you don't see the status code of this request. If you want the status code, you need to expand the custom dimension tag, and inside that you can see the status code. So 2000 bad request or something like that. Why in this evaluation, if gerentry file set, then exit, and not if not gerentry is empty, then exit? I agree. If not gerentry is empty, so if not gerentry, if gerentry is empty, if you want to skip the find set, if the gerentry is empty, it's good. Breaking up the base app is not something you want to do. I think that there are not more questions. So if there are no more questions, thanks to all of you. Some of you is well known by me. Some one of you is, I read about you something on comments on Twitter or something like others. So thanks to every one of you, people known and people not so known. Thanks to attend this session. Thanks to DynamicsCon. Thanks to the organizers. Hoping to see you live soon. And stop. I think that all is done for today. Thank you, everybody. Thank you to everyone.